So because Ethernet is a single shared bus, anything that you send, like anything that any host on an Ethernet sends, is in a very natural way broadcast over the entire network. At the higher levels of the network, that there may be abstractions that hide that broadcasting so that nodes will only receive traffic intended for them. But an analog electrical perspective, it's very much a broadcast network. So the repeaters simply forward the signal onto the other network segments, and then the terminators at the end of each segment absorb the signal to stop these problematic reflections occurring. And for the actual the encoding scheme that it uses on the wire is the Manchester scheme that we spoke about earlier in this video series. Oops, where's my cursor gone? So that was the bad old days of using coaxial cable. Then there was two versions actually of coaxial cable. There was ThickNet, which was the more expensive one. And then there was ThinNet, which was the one that had the T-pieces rather than the transceivers along the way. You're very unlikely to encounter either of these in any real network unless you're kind of doing computer archaeology or something these days. And you will see, though, that there's this kind of common naming convention for Ethernet. So especially for these sort of earlier standards of Ethernet. So the 10 is referring to the speed, base is baseband rather than it being up-modulated to a higher frequency band for the bandwidth. And then the number at the end is the length that you can have of the cable. So we went from the original 10 base 5 ThickNet, so this was longer distance, 500 meters, to the cheaper 10 base 2 networks, and now it was limited to 200 meters, but the trade-off was the equipment was a lot cheaper, and so of course it took off. Then Twisted Pair came along, and so they said, okay, we'll change the number at the end for a T to mean Twisted Pair, so 10 base T is baseband Twisted Pair 10 megabit, and is limited to of the order of 100 meters. And with Twisted Pair, it was common to have repeaters, but now you weren't on a single bus anymore, that each node had to have its own set of Twisted Pair cable. And so instead of a repeater, you had a hub that would have multiple ports, and any frame sent in on any one of the ports on the hub would be retransmitted to every other port on the hub by the hub. That was its function. So they were repeating the signal in that regard. So you could connect multiple hubs together via Ethernet. You could have a bunch of computers on one hub connected via a single Ethernet cable to a bunch of computers on another hub. So again, it's starting to get easier to build larger networks. So we've spoken a little bit about the Ethernet's media access control. And this is implemented in hardware by the network adapter. So it would start by sending a preamble of 64 bits of alternating ones and zeros. So this, again, if we remember the encoding part earlier, this helps the receiver to latch onto the clock of the incoming signal and to get a sense of what the high and low values are. It's also helpful with the carrier detection and collision detection. Then following that, we have the host and destination addressed. So Ethernet, they were quite clever. Immediately after the preamble, you have the very short packet type, and the destination occurs very, very, very early in the frame. And this is quite handy if you want to be able to switch Ethernet frames in a switched network very quickly, because you don't have to wait some distance in the packet to find the address of where to send it to. So Ethernet can get switched with a latency of of the order of 30, 40, 50 bits of transmission time on the network, precisely because it just needs to wait until it knows where it's going and buffer just those few bits, and then start sending them out on the correct interface or interfaces. Then we have this 16-bit packet type, and this is one of the things that's actually really powerful in Ethernet that's enabled it to keep up. So you can have, you know, there's a value that refers to, you know, the original kind of use of Ethernet. There's values for IPv4 or IPv6 encapsulation in Ethernet and various other protocols. And so as new features have been added, it's possible just to use these packet type numbers to provide that demultiplexing between those different uses. Originally, up to 1500 bytes, now on gigabit, and even actually on some 100 megabit Ethernet interfaces, you can do jumbo frames, typically of up to about 9000 bytes. A frame must be at least 46 bytes long so that the collision detection mechanism can work properly. And finally, we have a 32-bit cyclic redundancy check in there, which we shouldn't be too surprised about after the discussion on CRCs earlier. So again, if we have a look at that, we have the preamble, then the destination is the absolute first piece of data. So again, in terms of being able to do efficient switching, we can start switching it to its destination before we even know where it's from or what type of data it is. So this helps Ethernet to have very low latency and to have very low buffering requirements for the devices doing the relay, which again, in the earlier days when memory was expensive, this really was a significant advantage. So each host on Ethernet, in fact, in theory, every Ethernet host in the world has a unique Ethernet address. So these are 48 bits each, so 6 bytes long. And it's usually part of the network adapter itself, so that you don't have to allocate one. So as an Ethernet manufacturer gets allocated a block of Ethernet addresses and then uniquely allocates them out as they manufacture the physical network cards. Although a lot of modern systems will let you change the Ethernet address dynamically. So the Ethernet addresses commonly are printed as 6 hexadecimal bytes separated by colons and with leading zeros stripped off. And that's kind of how they're written. And that would correspond to, in binary, the same 48-bit value. But of course, it's just easier to read and write the nice compact hexadecimal figures. And as we say, each manufacturer tends to get allocated a block of addresses at a time. And so typically that will be a 24-bit prefix, and that will give them roughly 24 bits for address, which is about 16 million. So we can have, in theory, 16 million allocations of about 16 million Ethernet addresses. So this is more than ample. So it's 2 to the 48 is 64,000 roughly times 4 billion. So unlike IPv4, there's been no address space crisis on Ethernet as yet. So as we say, on Ethernet, if we're just using hubs, every frame transmitted on an Ethernet is received by every adapter connected to that Ethernet. And of course, this is particularly true for the earlier coaxial cable based forms of Ethernet. And then the adapter looks for its address in the header and only passes on those which are addressed to itself. Ethernet can also have broadcast frames that every adapter should get should receive. So if the address is all one, so FF colon FF colon FF colon FF colon FF colon FF, if we're writing it in the human readable form, is broadcast. Alternatively, you can have multicast, where you can send a frame that's meant for reception by multiple but not all receivers. This is possible to do as well with Ethernet. And it's sometimes used for doing, for example, bulk updates of computers around a network. You can send out the new software image, for example, via multicast to do it more efficiently than sending it via broadcast. And it was particularly helpful back in the 10 and 100 megabit Ethernet days, where it would otherwise take a long time. So in short, an Ethernet frame will receive all the frames that are addressed to itself. It will also receive all of the frames that are addressed to the broadcast address, and it will receive any frame that's been sent to a multicast address to which it has subscribed. So to which the connected computer says, hey, I'm interested in multicast frames with this Ethernet address. Okay, and we'll continue in the next video.